Please stand and join us as we sing. Isley, and I will be your worship leader and giving the talk, which is titled The Universal Realm. I had to think of it. It's written down, but we encourage you with the change in the CDC policies to wear a mask just to protect others. Let's stand and sing together we. And now let us affirm, I will light this Christ candle, which we light as a reminder to each of us that we are all divine beings, that we were created And that we are part of the ongoing creation of spirit. And that we are the reflection of the divine light. Each one of us a unique expression of spirit in this world. And we remind ourselves that whoever we meet, no matter where we are, without exception, we are meeting the divine in another. Let us affirm together our vision and mission statement. Centered in God, we inspire spiritual transformation, creating a world of love, peace, and prosperity. We are an inclusive spiritual community, inspiring, awakening, and serving in love. It's easy to look at the children in our life and remember what a blessing they are. And we want to bless all of those children. But we want to include all of the other children in the world, without exception. And then remember that inside of us, inside of each of us, there is a child as well. And we include this child as we bless each child in the world, as we affirm together our children's blessing. We love you, we bless you, and we behold the Christ in you. We accept you just the way you are. Walk in beauty, you are divine. And now please stand as we sing Sacred Love.
Thank you.
with the prayer chaplain, please bring forward the prayer box.
The sacred prayer box we keep in the back of the sanctuary so that it is in our midst. We bring it up at this time we bring it up at this time to hold it, all the prayers that are inside, in our own prayers. Of course, we do this once a week. And those of us that think about it, do it daily. From the prayer box, we send the prayers that we have gathered to Sacred Unity once a month. And they prayed over the prayers for a month. Prayer is one of our key spiritual practices. The prayers that we offer, we realize that Spirit already knows what we need and what we want. In fact, that Spirit has probably answered them as we pray them. But I believe that in the prayer that I connect with the prayers that I have and I'm praying. That consciousness is important. And I think in no other place quite as important as it is in prayer. So though Spirit knows, we need to connect ourselves with the prayers. And I would say that we hold these up so that we all can connect with whatever prayer is in here. We do not need to know what it is, but we know that Spirit knows.
At this time, I will read the daily word. The daily word today is radiance. The Christ presence within is my radiant source of good. On a clear day, when a stray cloud passes across the sun, I notice the suddenly diminished light. Then, looking up, I see the brilliant rays of sunshine surrounding the cloud. Instead of hiding the sun, the cloud helps me see and appreciate the sun's radiance. As the sun lights the earth and is the source of its energy, the Christ, the divine presence within me, is my light and source of everything that I need in order to live brilliantly and joyfully. When, like a passing cloud, an obstacle or challenge along my path may seem to dim my Christ light, I respond by looking up, by raising my point of view. I am reassured and strengthened, knowing that the divine radiance is shining as brightly as ever. No cloud can dim the divine light in me. And the scripture is from John chapter 1, verse 5. the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Please join me as we affirm together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we take this moment, this now present time, to pause, to go to that spiritual place within us, close to that presence that is always with us, but we're not always aware. We take a deep breath, gently, softly breathing in to fill our lungs until they are comfortably full, and then we release. We release and we relax into this now moment. Breathing in, a holy breath. We feel our bodies filling with life, that energy of life that comes directly from Source. And as we exhale, we eliminate from our being any obstacle that stands in the way of our spiritual growth. And we continue to breathe in our normal breathing pattern, and our body continues to relax. And as the body relaxes, the mind becomes more still. From this still place, we know the truth of who we are. We know that there is only one presence and one power in our life. And we know that we are each a reflection of the divine light, expressions of the divine in this world. It is this foundation, and it is from this foundation that we move into the silent and still place that is always available to us, that we call the silence, that silent and still place. It is from this silence that we may realize our guidance from Spirit. What is mine to do? Sometimes we hear it in a still small voice. Sometimes it is just a knowing. And sometimes we just experience the silence, and we wait patiently, knowing that all is in divine order. There is a feeling that comes from the silence. Feel it now. The compassion that we have for our fellow human beings. The joy of knowing the truth of who we are. The unconditional love as we see with our heart as God sees each of us. And with the spirit of gratitude, not for anything, only the feeling of gratefulness. We say thank you, and so it is. Amen. It's a beautiful day in my consciousness. I am so glad to see each one of you here this morning. The title of the talk today is The Universal Realm. Perhaps the greatest theme that Jesus taught us during his life in a body on the earth was of the experience of the kingdom of heaven. That's how it's normally translated into English. But when you look at these words, Malkuta Deshmaya, that's the Aramaic words that Jesus would have spoke. A more proper translation is universal realm. The universal realm. Malkuta is normally translated as kingdom. But that same word, just like many words in Aramaic, can have different meanings. Depending upon the context. Malkuta would be the same as saying the reign. In other words, it is now currently the reign of Queen Elizabeth in England. That would be Malkuta. Malkuta would also be the council, the guidance, the council. In other words, the monarch or the leader. Or in Israel at the time, there were, not long before Jesus' time, they didn't have kings. Before Saul, there was judges. And there, the judges gave counsel. You see? So that's Malkuta is also counsel. So we have the universal guidance that we get from the kingdom of heaven. I brought some Unity books today, so I wouldn't be only quoting from the Bible. This is Teach Us to Pray. It's listed as being written by Charles and Cora Fillmore. Cora is Charles' second wife, who he took after Myrtle passed on. And this is what he has to say about this universal realm. It is not a question of geographical locality, but of mental recognition. The kingdom of God is within you, said Jesus. Seeking God within changes our whole mental viewpoint. We find ourselves right in the presence of creative mind. And seeking to cooperate with this mind, we receive spiritual inspiration and are guided in even the most minute details of life. Charles was able to go into the silence and receive this guidance. This is so close to the meaning that comes from the original Aramaic. It's amazing to me. He was reading the same translations of the Bible that we have, probably the King James and then the American Standard Version. And yet, from the silence, he was able to discern this meaning. The kingdom is the place where we receive the guidance. Now, this book is The Atom Smashing Power of Mind. It is by Charles Fillmore. All persons in rare moments catch glimpses of this creative plan as a whole and of man's importance in its beauty and perfection. So there is this idea of divine order, this creative plan. And all of us, at times, catch glimpses of it in this universal realm. Even before we became aware that there was such a thing as truth, we were catching these glimpses. Most of the time, our mind, because of the way it was trained, the way we were educated, we just discounted these encounters, these glimpses, and just wrote them off and ignored them. But as we begin to be more aware of spirit, as spirit works in our lives, we can take this guidance and we can follow it. But how do we do that? How do we bring these glimpses from being some random encounter with spirit that just pops up and bring it more actively into our daily life? So now I'll turn to the Bible, to Matthew chapter 13 and verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure which is hidden in the field, which a man discovered and hid, and because of his joy he went and sold everything he had and bought that field. This person discovered that there was this treasure right here in the heart. So they hid it away so that no one else would find it, and went and sold everything they had so they could have this field and dig up this treasure. Why? What does it mean? Does that mean that I've got to go sell my house and my car and everything that I've got and go live in the desert? No, I don't think that's what that means. That's not what Jesus is trying to say here with this parable. To sell everything we have is to give the most valuable thing we have to Spirit. What is the most valuable thing we have? We all have it. That's our attention. Where is it that we place our consciousness? In every day-to-day situation, where are we placing our attention? That, giving that attention to Spirit, is selling everything we have so that we can uncover that treasure. When we give that attention, we're moving to a place where we're not thinking from our head. We're not becoming aware of our heart. We are becoming aware from our heart. It's a different type of knowing. In unity, Charles called it the silence. We are knowing from the heart. In fact, quite often, you'll hear it in unity books describing the silence as a state of non-awareness. And what they're telling us is we're not being aware from our head. We are being in a more subtle state of awareness. We're open to the presence. You see, there's a tale that's often told in the Buddhist tradition about a novice who studied very hard with all the masters. He read all the right books. And he found that there was going to be a spiritual teacher coming into town. And he got an appointment with the spiritual teacher. And he went into the audience, and the spiritual teacher was asked him if he wanted a glass of, a cup of tea. And the novice said, yes, I would love a cup of tea. So as the master began to prepare to pour the cup of tea, the novice began to explain to him all of the things that he had studied, all of the teachers that he had, everything that he knew. He just kept expounding all of this to the master. And the master started pouring the cup of tea. And the novice, as he was speaking, noticed that the cup was full. And the master just kept pouring the tea. And the tea overflowed from the cup and was all over the table. And finally, the novice stopped the master. He said, do you realize that you have overflown the cup? That you didn't stop pouring. Master teacher said, yes. And isn't that the state? See, I can't teach you because a full cup has no room for any more. Before spirit can fill us, we have to first empty the cup. And that is this teaching of being open. And that's why we go to the silence. Because as long as our mind, as long as our consciousness is just full of scattered thoughts and emotions, going here to there, grasping at whatever comes, we are like that cup of tea. And there's no room for any more liquid. It just goes all over the table. But when we can empty that cup, when our minds become still, when we're in the silence, there is a place now where we can receive from Spirit. I want to read another quote. This is from Longfellow, an American poet. Let us then labor for an inward stillness, and an inward healing, that perfect silence where the lips and heart are still and we no longer entertain our own imperfect thoughts and vain opinions. But God alone speaks in us, and we wait in singleness of heart that we may know His will, and in silence of our spirits that we may do His will, and do that only. It's that silence. Silence being the practice of going through that universal realm that is also called the silence. How do we do that? By becoming empty. And it takes practice. Have you ever tried, do you have a meditative practice where you sit and quietly wait? And if you do, then you've noticed. It doesn't matter how long you've done it. There's going to be times when all you get is just one thought after another. Emotions that just take over and run amok. But that's okay. You see, that's part of the practice of the silence. It's allowing those thoughts and emotions to just pass, not following them, and just going back to that silent and still place. Every time that our mind begins to be cluttered by these thoughts and our cup starts to overflow, we get an opportunity to return to stillness. You see, every thought and emotion that comes is an opportunity. Just like what I talked about last week with what is my life, that when we have these experiences in our life that cause us to go into these states of consciousness, these repetitive thought patterns that we get, we have an opportunity to go back to that realm, that universal realm. As we begin to watch ourselves, we can start to see these patterns. They're almost habits. Habits of mind, not necessarily habits of action, but habits of mind. And we can see them repeat in ourselves. That certain things will trigger certain inner states. So that we can begin to notice when we're in a situation that's about to trigger a certain state that's going to bring us away from the universal realm. And we can head this change of consciousness off by a change of our own. We can use our spiritual tools. That silence that we talk about, it doesn't have to be only something that we go to in the morning or when we sit down and have our silence time. That silence is a place that we can literally live from. It's out of this silence that we receive the guidance. It's not in the silence that we receive the guidance, it is out of it. We're in the state of silence, and then from that comes the guidance. And it's not only guidance about spiritual things. Remember, it can be about any type of activity that we're involved in. If we're a potter and we make lovely art or utensils out of clay, when we get in that universal realm, we get to be better at making those utensils out of clay. If our job is washing the dishes in this moment, and we do that job from this universal realm, then we not only wash the dishes better, but we are open to the communications from Spirit. When I led us in the guided meditation, I began by establishing a foundation. We begin each service with the same foundation, our opening statement. There is only one presence and one power. This oneness. Oneness is the foundation for the silence. The silence is something that we are invited to bring into our life. Into each moment. And it's one of those things that you just have to practice. Whether it's, you know, playing a musical instrument. You don't just pick it up and make music. When you first pick it up, you make noise. When you get in your car the first time to learn to drive, especially if it's got a standard clutch, it might jerk back and forth quite a bit. You might go a little too fast to go into the turn, you know. But the more we do it, the better we get at it. And the silence is the same way. So I encourage you to spend that time. Set aside some time each day. It doesn't matter when. And it doesn't matter how long. But I think it is important to say, I'm going to spend 5 minutes today in the silence. Or I'm going to spend 20 minutes today in the silence. Because that sets your intention. I can remember when I sat down for my time in the silence. And I wasn't in the silence probably 5 minutes. And I was in the middle of some thought. I was following it. And I got up on my feet. And I was headed to the door. And I had my hand on the doorknob. And I was opening it to go do whatever it was I came to. Tell you what it was. And I remember that, I'm spending time in the silence. So I had to take my hand off the door and return to my sitting. But the point is when you set that time and make an agreement with yourself, you're more likely to follow through, because there's going to be distractions. Those tasks that will wait are the ego consciousness spurring you out of the silence, because the ego really doesn't like you to spend that time. It likes to be the one in control. You know, the ego up here in your head. That place where judgments happen, where everything is this or that or that or that. And so, I encourage you to spend some time in practice of the silence. Affirmative prayer, as Unity teaches it, starts with the relax, relaxing mind and body, affirming truth. That's where we set our foundation. And then time in the silence. Out of the silence comes realization. We may or may not get a realization each time we go in the silence. And then we follow that up with gratitude. And that becomes automatic. Because when you come out of the silence and that stage of realization, there's a feeling that you get. And gratitude is a part of that. I want to close today with a song that I wrote. It is a song that came to me as Spirit was showing me one of the texts from the Nag Hammadi Library. And if you're not familiar with the Nag Hammadi Library, that is a collection of codices, books, old books, from probably the 2nd century, so the late 200s or early 300s, that were hidden in the desert in a jar and stayed there for hundreds of years. And they were hidden there because there was a group of monks that valued these writings, but they were told these writings were heretical, that you can only read certain books, and those certain books were collected together into what we call the Bible today. But they loved these scrolls, and they loved what they said, so they hid them so that they wouldn't be lost. And I was reading in called Codex number 13, one of these texts that's called the Trimorphic Protonoia. Trimorphic is three forms, and protonoia is a Coptic word that means first thought. These scrolls mostly were written in Coptic, which is a Semitic language that is written in Greek characters. It's the language that was spoken in Egypt at the time. You may have heard on the news about the Coptic Church. It came in the news as there was this unrest in Egypt during that particular summer. And what I'd like to do before I sing is to read you the words. That way your intellect can sit with them. And you can know what it is that I'm going to sing before I sing it, so that you are more easily able to just let go and allow these words to go into your unconscious, because you're already comfortable intellectually with them. So as I was reading this ancient text, these words just kind of leapt out at me and morphed into this song. Thought that dwells in the light. Movement that dwells in the all. Invisible one within the all. Protonoia. I am a voice speaking softly. I exist from the first. I dwell within the silence that surrounds everyone. And it is a hidden voice that dwells within me and within you. Silence, she is, called by three names, although she dwells alone, since she is perfect, protonoia. You may notice that it took the pronoun she. I think that's one of the first things that appealed to me, was that we have this idea, first thought, and in Coptic it's proginoia, which is a feminine word, so it takes the feminine pronoun she. So now I just invite you to take that, this is an opportunity to make that journey from the head to the heart and feel the vibrations as the music passes through you. Thank you. Give yourself. Give spirit. Some time in the silence. Debbie, would you like to lead us in the next song? Please join me as we affirm together our prosperity blessing. The inexhaustible resource of spirit is equal to every demand. There is no reality in lack. Abundance is here and now manifest. This is something new that we've added to the service. We started doing this on Zoom, and we liked it so much we thought we'd bring it forward into our face-to-face gatherings. And this is our opportunity that each of us has to share with our community those blessings that you've had throughout the week. How has prosperity felt for you? And we're not always talking about monetary things when we talk about prosperity. In fact, my experience has been that prosperity is about wholeness. Abundance is in everything that we do. Is there anyone who would like to begin with a share? Joan.
Well, I recently had some friends that have been ill, went in the hospital, and it just really made me realize I am so very blessed. I'm a youthfully mature person with perfect health, and I'm very grateful.
Thank you. Well, I've got a share. This happened to me on the way here this morning, and it began in an unusual way, because as I got in my car to leave for church, I live in Arab, which is a pretty good drive. I looked down at the gas gauge and noticed that I was sitting on a quarter of a tank, which wasn't going to be enough to get me a round trip, or maybe it would have gotten me a round trip back home, but it would have been really close at the end. So I decided that I would get gas when I got to Huntsville or on the journey back. And then as I was going up the four lane through town, I saw Fuel City on the right, and I said, well, I'll just go ahead and stop now and get gas. And I had left the house just right on time, so I was on schedule, I wasn't running late, but then I got to the gas pump and put in my credit card, slid it through the swiper so I wouldn't have to go in and pay, and it wanted my zip code. I thought, okay, no problem, I go to type in my zip code, nothing's coming up on the screen. It still says, enter your zip code. Try to click cancel. Nothing. It won't cancel. It won't reset. It won't do nothing. Well, I already put my credit card in there. I couldn't just leave it. Anyone else might get it to work, you know. Maybe they knew something I didn't know and could put in my thing. Because everybody, they had the same zip code. So I went inside, even though I really didn't want to give that time. And I know this is taking a while as a story, but I'll share it anyway. I come back out, she says, try a different pump, and it'll reset in 2 minutes. So I went to a different pump, swiped my card, got my gas, went by and checked. Yep, sure enough, it had reset. It was asking for a new card swipe. Okay, no problem. So I got my gas, I'm full on gas, I'm driving to Huntsville, and I get down into the valley off the mountain, and it starts to rain. And the further I go, the harder it's raining. So the blessing here is that I had an opportunity to see how I would react when the credit card thing didn't work, okay? And I felt rushed, so I got to see what was going on with my consciousness and then take some deep breaths and find my center again. And then I was blessed again because by the time I got to the gas station I would normally have stopped at, it was raining cats and dogs. And I was able to do all that in Arab without getting wet at all because it wasn't raining there yet. So I feel blessed, and Spirit works. You know, it's the small things sometimes that just feel so good and are so blessed. So at this time, does anyone else like to share a blessing?
I'll share.
Yes.
It's another story on the road.
Okay.
This was yesterday. We've been trying to transport our boat that we've had for 21 years from Ditto Landing to the marina at Wheeler Lake where our lake house is. And we've had all kinds of difficulties. The boat won't work. The mechanic hasn't contacted us for 2 months. And so it's just like one thing after another. So we finally decided that we were going to just trailer it up there, but the trailer had issues. So it was complicated. We had to, and we don't have a car to tow anymore. We used to. So we had to rent a U-Haul. we had to go pick up the trailer. We had to bring the trailer to buy used tires, otherwise it would not make it hauling that boat. And then we went to pick up the boat, and we had just pulled out of the marina, and we're going down the road, and it hit a bump, and all of a sudden we started going like this, and my husband Rob, he said he saw behind us that the boat was really wobbling, so he immediately pulled over and stopped, and the place where the, what do you call it, where you hook, you attach the trailer to
the hitch,
it wasn't secured all the way or something anyway. And so anyway, luckily there were these guys that came out and helped and put it back on, and then my husband just said, he felt really uncomfortable about hauling that boat on the road all the way to Athens. And we just felt it was like a sign from God. It was time to get rid of that boat. So what I'm grateful for is, like, in that moment, I mean, and there was this deep ditch. Immediately, I panicked and Rob panicked because we could have tumbled over into that ditch. And he actually saw that boat wobbling, and it was just like this instant, like, whoa, this could be it. And so I'm grateful. And it's interesting because when I was coming here, I actually noticed there was I went by so quick, there was emergency vehicles, a couple police cars. I don't know if you guys saw it, but
we heard it, but
there was a boat on its side. And so I'm thinking, maybe that's another sign. So anyway, I'm grateful, and I'm grateful. I'm also grateful for the unity between my husband and myself, because when he said that, it wasn't like I fought with him. No, my boat. It was just like, yeah, God is speaking to both of us, and we just felt very calm about it, and we brought the boat back to the marina, and then they figured out that there was a place where it hadn't, from the bottom somehow, the hit in the trailer, something wasn't working right, and it wasn't locking all the way. And then, so we said, well, we won't, and then in the meantime, the guy there had brought his friend out, who's a mechanic. And then the mechanic said, well, I've got this friend who I've been telling him forever, you've got to get rid of this boat. So maybe he'll buy this one. So we might have a seller.
Yeah. Okay. Would anyone else like to share? I think it's time for announcements. I have a couple of announcements. I should have said this in the opening, but we have visitors cards, and I know I got your email address. I hope, Steve, that you've got the first newsletter. Good. Well, we have this where you can sign up and get on our visitors log, and I'm not sure, Donna, if you have been on this either. So we've got these in the back if you want to fill that out, and let me know if you want to be on the newsletter if you're not getting it, because we send a newsletter out, and we never share your information with anybody. It's all right here within the church. And I send out a newsletter once a week. It comes out Tuesday night so that it'll be in your inbox on Wednesday morning. We have Sunday school upstairs. It starts at 9:30. We're currently discussing Discover the Power Within You by Eric Butterworth. But we will soon be starting a new book, because we're near the end of it finally, after probably 2 years. And that doesn't even count the time where we couldn't meet because of COVID. We take our time with these books. But the next book is going to be Lessons in Truth by Emily Cady. It's a foundational text for unity. Charles was very hesitant to write a book. And he asked Emily Cady to publish a series of 12 lessons that would be published in Unity Magazine, and that's where the book came from. We have a Wednesday discussion group that has not started back yet since the COVID, but we are working towards that as well. And I know Donna is planning a seminar coming up. We're not going to tell you the date yet because it's going to be in October, but you'll get more information as that date gets closer. I'm really looking forward to that class. It's going to be on those types of patterns that happen in our consciousness and how we can look at those and categorize those so that we can deal with them better. Is that a good description?
Great.
All right. We have another workshop that's coming up with our guest speaker. He's going to be on, he's going to be here in town. He's coming up from, I think, Florida. And he's a cancer survivor, but he's done amazing things. He, you know, triathlete, I mean, all of these things he's done since his recovery. And I really don't know what he's going to say, but I'm really looking forward to it. And that's the last Sunday of this month, and he'll be doing a workshop upstairs after service that day. Let's see, we've got an annual meeting coming up. So if you're not a member and would like to be a member, you can approach me. We can get your membership done. It's not too late. That if you want to be a member, then you can participate in the voting that happens at the annual meeting. We haven't set a date for it on purpose because we want new members and those who haven't sent in their membership renewal card to have an opportunity to do that. We know we're in really weird times because of the COVID. So just approach me if you'd like to be a member, or if you are a member and didn't get a card or something, we'll make sure that you get on the rolls. Does anyone else have any announcements of anything that needs to be talked about? All right, then let's stand and sing our peace song. St. Francis. Thank you so much for coming this morning to Unity Church on the Mountain. Have a blessed week, and take your opportunities when they come.